How are you? Are you ready for the word? I'm Pastor Tanisha. We're getting ready for the word. I'm also, you could also call me Grandma Tanisha. That's right. I am a newly minted grandma. I will be accepting all knitted shawls. I'll be accepting free walks across the street. I've realized that I need to get my church granny purse together with my red and white peppermints. I need some lifesavers. I need some Kleenex. What else I need in my granny purse? Y'all gonna have to help me. Anyway, I'm so glad to be with y'all today. We are ready for the word. Come on, put in the chat if you are ready for the word. I am ready for the word. I believe God has something for us today, family. So let's dive in. I know you're at home. You're probably in the bed or on your couch or you're having breakfast, but this is what I want you to do. I want you to try to lock in and let's just hear what God has to say to us in this moment. Y'all ready? Let me know if you're ready. Thumbs up, emojis, hands. I don't know. I'm imagining that you're doing these things. Okay, here we go. Today we are reading from the lectionary passage, Psalms 103, and we're going to read verse 1 through 8. So if you want to grab a paper Bible, go ahead. If you want to open it on your device, go. You do that. And we'll also have it provided for you on the screen, all right? Here we go. Oh, you know what? One thing. Brother Wayne, can you hand me that piece of paper right there on the edge? I left my notes for my scriptures. Thank you, Brother Wayne. All right, Psalms 103, it says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Come on, we could just shout right there. To bless the Lord means to speak well of God. It also says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefits. You got a benefit package, saints, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. Can I get an amen? The Lord works justice and righteousness for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the children or the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Can I get an amen? Actually, this verse right here preaches for itself, but we're just going to close our benediction. Bow your heads. No, just kidding. This is a rich word that we're going to dive into. Let's just have a time of prayer. Lord, we thank you for your word. God, we need a spiritual eye exam on today. God, we need new prescription in the spirit. We need to see you in a new way, in a different light. God, will you let your words go deep into our hearts and let us never be the same after this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The title of our talk today is Verzuz. The title for our talk today is Verzuz. Now, if you've been on Instagram in the last year, you will know about this phenomena called Verzuz. Come on, if you're in the chat, can you just begin to say, yep, I know Verzuz, put a hand emoji. Let me know if you know what this Verzuz phenomena is. If you really don't, or if you're not on social media, you might not know us. I'm going to hook you up on what's going on. Verzuz, also known as Verzuz TV, is a webcast series created by the producers Timbaland and Swiss Beats. It was conceived during the COVID-19 pandemic as a virtual DJ battle with Timbaland and Swiss Beats facing off in its first iteration through an Instagram Live broadcast in March 2020. All right, if you're familiar with these verses, you know that past battles have been a verse, T-Pain versus Lil Jon. And then we all remember the epic fail of Teddy Riley versus Babyface. Do you guys remember that? It was tragic. And then we had our sisters, Erica Badu versus Jill Scott. That was super dope. And then we had Rick Ross versus 2 Chainz. And then we even had like some gospel versions of it with John P. Key versus Hezekiah Walker. We had Fred Hammond versus Kurt Franklin. And most recently, we had Brandy versus Monica. Y'all, were you there for that? All right. It was epic. It was amazing. And then tonight there is a versus with Miss Patti LaBelle versus Sister Gladys Knight. I'm gonna get a big old plate of soul food and just watch it the whole time. It's just gonna be amazing. And in these versus battles, the two people will bring a whole catalog, all their repertoire, and just play it for the people. And the fun part is to hear all the songs you know, but it's even more fun to watch the comments because people are like super petty in the comments and hilarious. So this is like a great phenomenon. Like, I love it, right? But what if we had a Bible versus, right? What if we had these things where we just go head to head over issues or topics? Well, I would like to nominate our passage for today. Our passage is Psalms 103, and I want to nominate verse 7. Now, if you were to see verse 7, you would just fly right by it. You probably, if you blink your eye, you would miss it. But I want to go back and read verse 7, because I really think it's a powerful message for us today. It says, he made known, we're talking about God. God made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. I'm going to say it again. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. So I see a versus happening today. I see a versus battle happening with God's ways versus God's acts. All right, you got it? We got a versus going on today. God's ways versus God's acts. God made known his ways to Moses, but he made his acts. His acts to the people of Israel. Now, I just want to lay out for you. You might say, okay, what is this? I want to lay out a case for you today that it's not enough just to know God according to God's acts. Instead, I want to convince you that God is inviting us to know him according to his ways. That is my goal today. And so today we're going to discuss two groups of people. In the first two camps, all right, two camps, if you will, of a group of people who only knew God according to his acts. And then one man who took it a step further to know God according to his ways. Now, why is this important to you? Why should you listen? What's the so what of this message? This is a good time, family and friends, to take a minute and pause. It's a good moment to evaluate your walk with God. You can evaluate what camp you're truly in. And God is inviting us. I feel like God is inviting us on today from this superficial into the real. So let me just see. Maybe I want to test out to see if this sermon is for you. If you find yourself complaining a lot in this season, this sermon might be for you. If you feel like super stressed and worried, this sermon just might be for you. If you find yourself doubting God or wondering where God is and why and have like a lot of questions, this sermon just might be what you need on today to get you over this hump. Because honestly, both camps are great. God's ways and God's acts, they're both great, but one is better. Just like the versus battles on Instagram. There's always one better, right, Brandy? I'm not going to be petty. There's always one better, Brandy. But there's, and then just like being, you guys remember it in regular times when we went to amusement parks? Remember amusement parks? Remember when we did things and the air wasn't barbecued? Remember that time? Just like when we are at amusement parks. Being at a park is great, But having a fast pass is better, right? Being at a concert is so good. Like, I'm there, we there, throw your hands in the air. But having backstage passes, that's better, right? Being at a game is so fun. Even if you in the nosebleeds, you're like, I can still see the ants down there. Like, well, I'm just glad to be here, right? But having court-sized seats or being on the field is better. I believe God is inviting us into better. A lot of us are just existing on good, but this is an invitation today to draw you into better. How many people are ready? Come on, put better in the chats. Say, I want better. This has been good, but I want better. I believe the people of God want better. All right, well, let's go. We're going to talk about two camps. I'm going to start out by talking about the first camp of people. The people who only knew God according to his acts, his miracles, signs, wonders, all those things, all right? So this story picks up in the book of Exodus with the children of Israel. These people have been in slavery and in bondage for 400 years. And God sends Moses to deliver these people. And with a strong man, I mean, God was like, look, here's the deal, Moses. I'm about to show out. I'm about to do all kind of things. And look, this is why he was going to do it. I'm going to do these things so that the Egyptians know that I am God. There was a purpose for his mighty acts. I'm going to do these things. And you will notice if you keep reading the Old Testament, God would always use this moment in the life of the children of Israel as his moniker. But going forward, he will always say, hey, I'm the one that delivered you from the hand of Egypt. I'm the one that took you out of the Red Sea and brought you into the Promised Land. This would be what God is like. This is what I'm going to be known for. This is what you're going to remember me for, right? This is why he do it. And it seems like that should be the end of the story. God delivered the people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. They crossed through the Red Sea. It was amazing. And then they lived happily ever after, the end. Because surely they saw all the things. And anything they needed after that, they would have been like, well, he brought us through the Red Sea on dry land. Like, we literally walked on dry land through a sea. So I know anything we need, God got us. End of the story, right? The end. Praise God. Well, I wish I could say that is the end of the story. But this group of people that we're talking about were only interested in knowing God according to his acts because they kind of had a what can God do for me mentality. All right, here we go. Y'all ready? We turn into Janet Jackson at this point in our lives. God, what have you done for me lately? If this is the theme of your life, it's time to change the record. We need a new CD playing. Your CD is skipping. It's so hard, and it's not a good place to be when you're only following God because of his acts. Because if something tends to happen, and we see this with the children of Israel, even though God does amazing things, we tend to forget. What is this about us? What is this thing we have in human nature that makes us forget? I got receipts. Y'all want to know? Let's go to Psalms 78, 11 through 19. I got receipts. We tend to forget as people. It says in Psalm 78, it says, they forgot his works. This is the children of Israel. They forgot his works and the wonders he had showed them. In the sight of their fathers, he performed wonders in the land of Egypt, in the fields of Zoan. Check at all the things God did. He divided the sea, let them pass through it. He made the water stand up like a heap. In the daytime, he led them with the cloud. And all night with the fiery light, he split rocks in the wilderness. He gave them drinks abundantly as from the deep. He made streams come out of rocks. He caused waters to flow down like rivers. Yet they sinned more against him, rebelling against the Most High in the desert. They tested God in their heart, demanding the food they crave. They spoke against God, saying, can God spread a table in the wilderness or not? I added or not. That's not in the Bible. That is what happens, especially in adversity. We tend to forget God. Do you remember when we first opened in Psalms 103, it says, don't forget the Lord's benefit. We have to continually remind ourselves about the goodness of God because we tend to forget even when God does great things, especially in times of adversity. We tend to forget God. And when we forget, we tend to complain. And when every time we complain, we become like the children of Israel. Do you know if you were to read Exodus and Numbers, read those two books, and just go through and highlight every time the people grumbled, complained, or murmured. It's amazing. Every time God did something amazing. But now we're hungry. But now we want water. But now we can't. Where are we going? We should have just murmured and complained. And you know, this is difficult for us because we now live in a society where grumbling, complaining is cute. We do it on social media. We make jokes and memes about it. We grumble, murmur, and complain all day. When we have to catch that spirit, because this is the spirit that really displeased the Lord. This is the thing that really tested his nerves against the children of Israel. Like, I've done all these things, and y'all still got something to say. So every time we forget, we tend to complain. And you know why else it doesn't really pay off just to know God according to his acts? We become addicted to signs. Like, I always need a sign. Anybody been there? Like, I just need one more sign. Like, you pray like, God, please show me. And God shows you. And you're like, ooh, okay, I was tripping. Okay, if that was really true, though, send somebody with a green shirt to walk across the street and hand me a cup of coffee and then give me $2 on the side. Like, we do all these incredible things like Gideon did, like, do the fleece, turn the fleece over, make it dry, make it away. We do all these things. We become addicted to signs. Have you been there in your life before where all you're living is from sign to sign? God, show me this. Okay, well, I'm confused. Show me that. I just need a big sign from the Lord. We don't want to become sign addicted. That is a symptom that you only know God according to God's acts. This is problematic, because when you know God in this way, acts, they don't replace a relationship with God. See, the children of Israel, like, hey, God's on our side. We don't really need to know him, so he's just going to do things for him. Kind of like God becomes our cosmic butler. Like, God, I just need you to do things, you know, this is what I need. It does not replace. God desired a relationship with his people, and all they wanted him for was his acts. They sought his hand and not his face. Can I get an amen? Acts alone will not cause you to believe in God. Isn't that amazing? You can see all the signs, all the wonders. If you were to study the children of Israel, they saw so much. Go ahead, do a study on all the miracles in the wilderness. They saw incredible things, and yet their heart was still hardened towards God. Just because you see something, just because God does something, just because you cut a deal with God and he comes, that does not mean that you really believe in God. And lastly, acts alone will not save you, boo-boo. Just because God comes through or does this amazing thing or you have this great story, that doesn't necessarily save you. Belief in God is what saves you. You know what? Let's take a time out. I got to tell you a sad story. There's a super sad story. Read it on your own. You got time. It's a pandemic. Read Exodus 19 and 20. It's the saddest story. Let me tell you why. We're going to take a time out, take a breath, quick digress. The story in Exodus 20, you got to read it. God did all the things for the people. You got to read it. In chapter 19, God's like, look, I'm coming. I'm going to make this mountain holy. I'm going to, like, come and show my people who I am. I'm just going to show out, right? I'm going to do all the things. And Moses, they going to know that you with me, and they going to listen to you. So get the people ready. Make sure they don't touch the mountain. He had all these rules. In chapter 20, God came through. This is not in our thing. You can look in on your own time. I'm just going to read it real quick. Now, All the people saw the thunder and the flashing of lightning and the sounds of trumpet and the mountain smoke. And I told you, God did all the things. He's like, I'm going to show y'all all the things, right? The people were afraid and trembled, and they stood afar off and said to Moses, you speak to us and we'll listen, but do not let God speak to us lest we die. And the people said, and Moses said to the people, don't fear. God has come to test you, that you may fear him, and that the fear of him might be before you, that you may not sin. 21 is so important. It says, but the people stood far off while Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. It's the saddest story. Like, God did all the things. He was like, I'm going to just show y'all all the things. And it was like, we don't want it. It's too much. You know what, Moses? You speak for us. Just tell us what God said, and we'll be good. Isn't that so like us? That's what we do with religion. Like, that's what we do with the preacher. Like, hey, y'all just preach. Listen, what did God tell you to do? For me, just tell me what. I don't really need to talk to God for myself. You just tell me what God said. We go to people, can you pray for me? I need direction or guidance. I don't necessarily want to seek God myself. I just want you to tell me what God said to me. The people stood far off. Which camp are you in today? Are you in the camp where people, where you stand afar off from God? Or are you like Moses? There was something inside of Moses that said, I don't care what y'all do. I don't care if y'all stay far off. This is God. I feel his presence. And I'm going to go into where he is. I'm going to draw near to God. Do I have any Moseses who are watching online, who will say that, yeah, that's me. I feel faith rising up. I don't want to be the one that stands far off anymore. I want to go straight to where God. I feel God pulling. I feel God pushing my heart. I feel God wooing me closer to his presence. This is so interesting. Let's pivot over to Moses. Moses drew near. Remember, we have two camps. We in the versus battle. We already talked about the people who only know God according to God's acts. Now let's pivot over to Moses, who leaned into exactly what acts, what miracles, what signs, what wonders are for. Do you know what all those things are for? Is it just so we could go like, wow, that's great? Do you know God does all these things with a specific purpose? And it's always to draw us nearer to God. And it's always to reveal his character. Two things. Every time you see a miracle, a sign, a wonder, an act, a mighty act of God, it's always just to draw you closer to the heart of God. And it's always to show you God's character. Remember, our brother Moses, he saw all the things that all the people seen. He saw all the things up to this point. They've been through plagues. They've been through manna. They've been through fires and grounds open up, just name it. He's seen all the things. But something in his heart drew him closer. Check out Exodus 33:13. This prayer will change your life. This is the prayer that Moses prayed. Remember, he saw everything that the children of Israel saw. And instead of standing far away, this is the prayer Moses prayed. Now, therefore, if I have found favor in your sight, please show me now your ways, that I may know you in order to find favor in your sight. Oh God, show me your ways. I've seen all your acts. I've seen all the things. God, I went up into the darkness. I went up, God, when people ran for you, I drove, something was drawing me closer to your heart. God, show me your ways. What a beautiful prayer. If this is your prayer, come on, put in team ways. Are you team acts or team ways? Because I think this is where God is drawing us to. What are God's ways? What are you talking about, Moses? You already saw all the things. Now you want to know God's ways. What is the difference? What are you saying? Well, you know, it's very interesting that God answered this prayer of Moses's in the next chapter, in Exodus 34. And it's also super interesting for all the Bible geeks out there that the passage we read today, Psalms 103, also included God's answers. So let's show that. Is Exodus 34 and 6 and Psalms 103 and 8. This is what God told Moses. This is when he says, show me your ways. I'm like, okay. God's like, okay, this is who I am. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. This is what God said about God's own self. And then in our lectionary passage today, it says again in verse 8, 103:8, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. This is the God we serve. You want to know God's ways? This is how God always operates, from this lens. This is the lens that God always sees us through. This is what God is inviting us into. See, when you know God's ways, you know God's character. Come on, somebody say character. You could even put it in the chat. Say God's character. Huh, this is where we get to know who God really is. Not who you dreamed God up to be. Not your spiritual Santa Claus. Not your genie in the bottle. Not Aladdin. But who God really is. You know, if our brother and sister, Brother Adam and Sister Eve, would have had a right perspective of who God is, they probably wouldn't have been deceived so easily. When the serpent came to Eve and said, man, God don't want you to be smart. Hey, eat this fruit. You know, God, he don't even want you on his level. Wouldn't have been something if Eve would have been able to be like, nope, I know how God is. I know his ways. God's not even like that. That's not his way. God is abounding in love. He's gracious. His love is, he's not trying to hold anything back from me. He loves me. What if Eve would have answered that if she would have known God's ways? Also, when we know God's ways, we know God's mannerisms. Come on, somebody put mannerisms. You might need to do your spell check. Don't worry. Mannerisms. You know, you can only know somebody's man. You know when you really get to know someone's mannerisms? You really only get to know someone's mannerism when you live with them. Can I get an amen from any roommates, partners, spouses, siblings, friends, loved ones, and exes and enemies? You only really get to know someone when you live with them. And when you live with people, you tend to learn about their mannerisms, right? Like what they like, what they do every morning at the same time is going to be coffee and bacon. Or every night, they're going to come straight in. They're going to go straight to the bathroom. Like we know people's mannerisms once we live with them, which makes sense why Jesus wants us to abide in him. So when we abide with God, that's when you get to know what God likes, what God doesn't like, what are God's mannerisms. You know, our God is a mystery, but yet there are patterns. If you go through the Bible, we can never fully explain God. Can we just put that on the table right here, right there? Our finite minds can never really process all of who God is. Like there's not enough words to explain. We don't even have the right name for God. Like you know, we say him or his, where God is really non-gendered, and God always describes God's self as God is like a father. God is like a mother hen. God is like a rock. He's so amazing that we can't even describe him. So let's just put that on tape. God is a mystery, but anybody like true crime? What y'all? Well, SVU? Y'all like all them detective shows? It's just a million of them. You know, on every detective show, they always have like, when there's a person of interest, they look for their MO, right? Their modus operandi, their mode of operation. They try to sense a pattern about this person. And when we're getting to know God's ways. We're looking at God's MO. What is God's mode of operation? Even though our God is great and mighty and unfathomable, we can still sense a pattern throughout the scriptures. Have you gotten to know God? Do you know God's MO in your life? Here's a few things that I've noticed in the scriptures when we look at God's mode of operation. God is always taking something from nothing. Have you noticed that about God throughout the scriptures? He spoke the world into existence. He didn't even make it. He just spoke it. He's always taking something out of nothing. You know what else I've noticed about God? God likes small things. There's so many stories in the Bible where God starts with little boy David, a little rock, little boy's lunch. God likes things little. There's a little cloud that we saw in the sky that's going to bring rain. God likes things that are little. He likes to things that you would never even think of using, and that's where he likes to multiply it and just show out. You know what else God likes? God likes using unlikely people, right? People who would never, you probably wouldn't even consider them. Most of the heroes of the Bible were unlikely, ordinary people that got looked over by their family and friends, didn't look like they were going to amount to anyone, but God is like, you're the one I want. You're the least likely. See, you're going to be my, take them by storm. They're not even looking for you, and this is how God operates. Come on, we have to know God's MO. You know what else? God likes to use people with questionable past. I don't want you to put your hand in the chat or raise your hand. I don't want you to give away your path. But if you feel like it, you've gone. If you got a questionable path, I ain't trying to put your business out there. But you can put an amen. If you be like, if you have a questionable past, then congratulations. You are a perfect candidate for God to use, because he loves to use people who people count out. And God takes the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. This is God's pattern. You know what else? God can't lie. How about that? Do you all know people in your life who all they can do is lie? Like they don't just, everything that comes out their mouth is just a lie. You already know not to believe it. We know people like that. But on the opposite of that, God is a person who can't even lie. All he could do is speak true. This is God's pattern. So whenever God speaks something to you about your life, you got to know that God can't lie. And the enemy is always coming to you to try to doubt the very words of God, just like he did to Eve in the garden. Did God really say? And that's when, if you know God's ways, you can say, yeah, okay, I hear you, but my God can't lie. My God loves me. This is how God operates. Yeah, I look like I'm not qualified. Yeah, I look like I'm the least likely to do God's work, but that's just who he uses. I've seen him time and time again. God loves to use small things. He can't lie. And this is the last one. We're just talking about God's ways. This is the one I love the most. God loves to set up dramatic scenes just so he can get the glory. Have you noticed this in your life? Do you ever wonder why it always comes down to the wire? Like, God, that's what the old folks like, may not come when you want them, but it's always on time. Because this is how God operates. Look at the children of Israel. God led them out of Egypt, led them straight to a sea on one side and a mountain on the other side, and a big army, the best of Pharaoh's army, chasing them. It looked like all hope was lost. It's a dramatic scene. It would be like the scary movie, the tense movie, music. It would have all been happening. And God will do things just like that. He'll set up the dramatic in your life just so he could get the glory. Just so you could walk away saying, "Whoo, that was nobody but God." Can I get an amen? Can I get a witness out there? Have you been through anything in your life where you can walk away from and be like, "You know, that wasn't nobody but God"? Then congratulations, you just been set up. We need to do like a new show, those prank shows, and be like, "You've been set up by God." Instead of getting mad and like, "Oh, I wonder what's going on. God, where are you? What are you doing?" Hey, if you understand God's ways, it'll help you to relax a little more. Oh, this is what God always do. God always showing out. God always wait till the last minute. But watch. He going to work it out. Oh, God, don't look like I don't have enough money. Just watch. I know God's ways. I know how God operates. This is what Moses was saying, is how can I know your ways? Knowing God's ways will be like, look, it looks bad right now, but I know God's coming through. It looks like my back is against the wall, I'm between a rock and a hard place, but watch God make a way out of no way. Because we serve the God who says, I am gracious and merciful. I'm slow to anger. I love that slow to anger, because somewhere we begin to believe that God is walking around with a lightning bolt ready to strike us at any moment. That, according to this verse, when we know God's ways, that's really not the case. God is gracious, giving us chances we don't deserve. Slow to anger. He's not ready to send you to hell at a moment's notice. Slow to anger and abounding in love and faithfulness. We serve a mighty God. Can I get an amen? Now, you're probably wondering, we're back to verses. Remember God's ways versus God's acts. Now, you're probably wondering why this camp is so empty over here. You had all the children of Israel, millions of people are in the God's Acts camp. And you got one little guy, Moses, is over here in God's Ways camp. It's a little lonely over here in the God's Ways camp. You want to know why? There's a few caveats to being in the God's Ways camp. Let me just let you know before you sign up for the camp and put in your registration. Let me just let you know. There's one small caveat if you want to know God's ways. And it is that you have to give up your way in order to find God's ways. And that's tough. That's tough for us human beings, because we all have an inner three-year-old that says, I just want it my way. I want it my way. It's my money, and I want it now. Like, we want everything now. We want it instant. We don't want to wait. We don't want it in line. I just want it my way. God, here's my list. This is my 5-year plan. All I need you to do is bless it. Just take it and bless it. You don't even have to do nothing to it. I already got it perfectly aligned. I know where I'm going and who I'm going to be going with. So just take this and bless it. If we are to follow God, we have to give up our own way. We have to give up our own way. This is what the children of Israel found out. And this is in Psalms 95. We won't go there, Mike, but I just want to tell you. Oh, yeah, let's just go there real quick. If y'all would just indulge me in one more scripture. Psalms 95:11. God says, of these same people, this is when they complained that they didn't have no water. He said, today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart as in Meribah, as on the day of Massa in the wilderness, when your fathers put me to the test and put me to proof, that though they had seen my work, for 40 years I loathed that generation and said, they are a people who go astray in their heart. Why? Because they have not known my ways. God said, therefore, I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Friends, we have the same problem. We see God do mighty things, and we harden our hearts toward it because we just can't see it. We want it. We want God to do things our way. And let me let you know, we serve a mighty God. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. And a lot of times, we want God to do it our way. And this is not how this works. We are here to serve God. He is not here to serve us. We are here to worship and give glory to him. He's not here to be our cosmic robot. So we have to surrender our way to God. This is really touching on the heart of a lot of our problems. Give your way to God. We want God to do things our way. And you know what God said according to this verse? People who only know God according to his acts, they never know his rest. There is a rest that comes upon you when you do things God's way. There is a supernatural rest, and when you try to do it on your own, when you try to do your, and when you just want your way and you just want it the way you want it all the time, there's no rest for you in that. You will always be working. You will always be striving. You will always be bumping your head. Come on, God is inviting us into rest. How many people are going to take that rest? God reveals this to us. Remember, he said he made known his ways to Moses. This is a revelation. This is nothing you could go and buy. This is nothing you could go and, like, I'm going to read 5 books and then I'll know God's ways. Yes, we have the word of God, but it takes God to reveal God's way to you. And just remember, every versus battle, both are good, but there's always one better. I believe God is inviting us to lean into better. Someone say lean in. Lean in and allow God to make his ways known to us. Because God doesn't hide. He's not hiding from you. He's ready to pour out his goodness on you. So in closing, I just want to point out that Moses was an excellent model for us New Testament believers. Come on, pat yourself on the chest if you are a New Testament believer. This is for us. Moses was an excellent example because in Exodus 33:11, it says that God would speak to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend. And this was weird because no one talked to God face to face back then. It was like, what? Who does that? The people didn't even want to go up to a mountain, but that was a preview for us to show us exactly how he wants to have a relationship with us. He wants to speak to us face to face as a man. This is not something to be weird. This is something that God is calling us into. And you know what? I think we could go even deeper than that. Y'all want to go deeper than that? When we read these verses, we kept hearing Moses say, God, teach me your ways. If you were to read through the Psalms, all the writers, would multiple times say, God, teach me your way. They would just cry out, teach me your way. But check it out. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Congratulations, y'all. We have the way manifested. Jesus is the way. The thing that they prayed for in the Old Testament, guess what? We have Jesus manifested. When Jesus died on the cross, when he rose again, he gave us access to the Father. This is the thing that Moses, it was so amazing. He had a preview of what we can live into every day. Because when Jesus died, he created a new and a living way for us to have fellowship with the Father. So this is our opportunity to lean into the way. Who is the way? The way is Jesus. I'm proud to be a part of this church. Because this church is called the Way Christian Center. We are people of the way. We are followers of the way. Who is the way? The way is Jesus. When you say, God, teach me your ways, you're saying, Jesus, make yourself more known to me. Let me see a different facet of you that I've never seen before. Everything we need is found in Jesus. You know, the old saints used to say, you know, any question, all you have to do is the answer is Jesus. What do you need? Peace, Jesus. I need some money. He's a provider, Jesus. I need comfort. He's the Holy Ghost, Jesus. Everything we need has already been provided in the way. Come on, put in the chat, say, I am a follower of the way. Jesus is our sign. Do you know that? Jesus is our sign. So every time you're looking for a sign, all you have to do is call on the name of Jesus. Jesus is the sign. The sign is that he died, that he was buried, and that he rose again. There's your sign. You need a sign. The sign is Jesus. We have access to God. He is the answer to every question. Can I get an amen? So saints, thank you for coming to this versus battle. I hope that I have laid out an argument to convince you that knowing God's ways are better than just knowing him according to his acts. We have a couple of takeaways, then I'm just going to close in prayer. We got takeaways, #goals. This is what we want to walk away with today. Number one, don't camp at the sign. What does that mean? Don't camp at the sign. If you were going to Yosemite and you were traveling on the road and you saw the sign, Yosemite, 50 miles away, you would not stop at that sign, get out, and set up your tent right there. I saw a sign. I'm just going to stay right here. No, remember, the sign always points you somewhere. The sign is always pointing you to your destination. So don't camp at the sign. The destination is Jesus. Number two, surrender your way for God's way. Always live with an open hand. Can you put your hand out right now? With an open hand. Come on, put your hand out. Put your hand out. This is a symbol of your life. God is free to put in it or take away from it at any time. We don't want to live with our fists balled up or God can't put anything in or take anything out. Everything in our life is open-handed. God, you give and take away. Blessed be your name. Always live with an open hand. Thirdly, trust God's character, especially in adverse or confusing times. Remember God's mannerisms. Remember the way he operates. Remember God's character. And lastly, ask God to reveal more and more about Jesus every day, because he is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. Father, we come before you. Thank you so much for this word. God, we are determined to be in team, know your ways. Lord, we no longer want to just follow you according to your acts. We don't want to just follow you for the things that you could do for us. God, we don't want to follow you just because we are looking for a miracle or a handout. Or we don't want to be like the people who just followed you around for the bread. God, we want to know you. We want to be in relationship with you. We want to abide with you. We say, God, teach us your way. And we know that your way is always the right way. We want to live our lives your way. We want to live our lives your way. So God, bless us. God, bless us to lean into relationship with you. Help us to study you more. Help us to learn about you more. The only way you can know about someone is to live with them. So teach us how to live with you every day, to pray and abide in you. God, we thank you that you're going to open up our minds and just give us more revelation of you. We love you. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And thank God. As we close, I'm going to bring Brother Wayne up to close us out. But just before we do this, if you are hearing this message and you don't know who Jesus is, you don't know that Jesus is the way, I just want to give you this short moment to let you know that Jesus loves you, that Jesus has a plan for your life. And all you have to do is just believe. The Bible says that all we have to do is believe on the Son of God. Believe that he died, that he rose, that he has a plan for us. So if you don't know who Jesus is, just invite him into your life and say, Lord, I believe in you. Thank you so much for this time. We love you, Way family. I'm going to hand it over to